Lights. We humans are diurnal creatures, meaning our bodies and brains are adapted to being active during the day when there's light. But the invention of ways to light up our homes and businesses during the dark of night has revolutionized the way our society functions.
Would you light my candle?
But pushing back the darkness has also had some negative side effects that we know as light pollution. So what is light pollution, and how does it affect the other living things with whom we share this planet? When most of us hear the phrase light pollution, what we're actually thinking of is astronomical light pollution. This is when artificial lights obscure our view of the night sky, including being able to see stars, planets, and other things in space. If you'd like to learn more about the effects of light pollution on humans, as well as some ways that we can reduce light pollution, head on over to hear from my friends at Quick Fix.
Okay, so remember that perfect date when you wanted just to end the night by stargazing and ... Well, it's not just you and the younger generations that are suffering because of the light pollution.
Older generations living in areas with a lot of light pollution take more sleeping pills compared to their friends living in dark areas. And besides sleep disorders, bright nights also contribute to depression, obesity, diabetes, headaches, and even cancer.
But that's not all. Head over to Quick Fix channel and learn how to, well, fix things. Back to you, Sheryl.
While astronomical light pollution and its effects are definitely problematic, I'd like to talk about another facet of this issue, ecological light pollution. Pretty much any and all artificial light, including vehicle lights, street lamps, signs on businesses, lights on undersea research vessels, lights on offshore oil platforms, and the distant glow of cities can contribute to ecological light pollution. Almost 20% of the Earth's land surface is polluted by astronomical light standards, but this doesn't include oceanic light pollution, or the fact that ecological light pollution often has a much lower threshold than astronomical light pollution.
Baby, you light up my world like nobody else.
Although research on the negative ecological effects of light pollution is only a few decades old, we already know several very important things. For instance, light pollution isn't just about constant artificial lighting. Sudden changes, like turning a light on or off, can also be very problematic for wildlife. Interestingly, the weather can actually work against us to make light pollution worse. On nights when it's cloudy, the glow from cities can be reflected and amplified by cloud cover.
When the lights go down in the city.
So why exactly is light pollution such a problem? Unfortunately, just as artificial lights have allowed humans to be active after the sun goes down, light pollution can disrupt the circadian or day-night cycles of animals and plants. Species that live in the tropics are adapted to fairly regular day-night cycling, so light pollution that makes the day longer or irregular could disrupt them. At the opposite ends of the Earth, animals living near the poles are adapted to a very long night and a very long day, but light pollution could break up the night or make it much shorter than it's supposed to be. And animals that live in the temperate regions between the poles and the tropics aren't safe either. Many species in these areas use changes in the length of day, called photoperiod, over the seasons as cues for different stages in their life cycles. If light pollution makes the days seem longer too early, they can be affected too.
And at last I see the light.
Perhaps the most famous example of animals negatively affected by light pollution is sea turtles. When baby sea turtles hatch out of their nests in the sand, they use the contrast between the darkness of the ocean and the relatively brighter night sky to find their way into the water. But artificial lighting on buildings and cities farther inland confuses the hatchlings and causes them to navigate in the wrong direction. But that's all I'm going to say about sea turtles, because this example has been addressed many times already by other people. Let's take a look at some lesser known examples to see just how far the problem of light pollution spreads. This one sounds obvious once I say it, but nocturnal animals have eyes that are adapted to functioning in very dark conditions. So yeah, light pollution can literally blind them and make them unable to find food, shelter, or mates.
blinded by the light.
Speaking of finding food in the dark, since light pollution makes the nighttime seem more like day, it can really mess up the schedules for many predatory animals. This might mean that daytime predators stay active well after they would normally stop hunting, which can lead to competition between diurnal and nocturnal predators. For instance, daytime birds might continue to forage for insects in areas that would normally be hunted by bats after dark. Light pollution can also affect how prey animals behave at night. Since brightly lit areas are places where predators would be able to see them easily, many prey animals choose to avoid these places when foraging for their own food. This may protect them from becoming food, but what if too large an area is polluted with artificial light? It's possible the prey animals in that area would starve or leave if they weren't able to safely find food. Though we normally think about light pollution affecting nocturnal animals because it lights up the night, diurnal animals can also be harmed by this situation. When diurnal birds migrate through cities, they tend to become trapped between lighted buildings because they don't feel safe in dark areas. This puts the birds at danger of flying into windows. Some studies estimate as many as 988 million birds die from window strikes in the US every year. And if they don't die from hitting windows, the trapped and disoriented birds are now also great targets for urban predators like coyotes, raccoons, and domestic cats.
Every street lamp seems to beat a fatalistic warning.
Speaking of street lamps, I don't think I have to tell you that many insects are attracted to light. Scientists call this instinct to move towards light positive phototaxis, and a lot of insects have it. The insects can fry themselves on hot light bulbs, and hovering around artificial lights makes insects easy prey for hunters like bats. The sounds produced by some artificial lights can even interfere with moths' ability to hear bat echolocation sounds, so they're unable to avoid being eaten. And we can't forget about the insects that actually make light themselves. That's right, fireflies, or lightning bugs, whatever. And glowworms communicate using light they make in their bodies, so light pollution from artificial sources can interfere with their ability to find mates.
You would not believe your eyes if 10 million fireflies lit up the world as I fell asleep.
But a lot of what we've talked about so far are generalities. I'd like to take a more in-depth look at a few specific case studies to show you just how serious the ecological light pollution problem can be. A lot of researchers consider amphibians to be the canaries in the coal mine when it comes to environmental problems caused by humans, because this group of animals is usually very sensitive to changes in their environment. Amphibian populations around the world have been declining for a variety of reasons, but light pollution may be adding one more log to the proverbial fire. Light pollution has been shown to negatively impact amphibians in at least three ways. First, like I mentioned before, many prey animals reduce their activities in brightly lit areas to avoid being caught by predators. This is also true for adult frogs. Usually, male frogs will call loudly and hop around to try to find females, but if there's too much artificial light in an area, those males will sit still and quiet, and that means no baby frogs get made. If eggs are laid, light pollution can also affect their development, as crazy as that sounds. Experiments have shown that tadpoles exposed to light pollution can have delayed metamorphosis, meaning they stay in their juvenile body shape longer. This is problematic for many reasons, including predation and lack of reproduction. But since many frogs lay their eggs in ponds that are seasonal, meaning they'll dry up at certain times of year, if those tadpoles don't have any way to leave when the pond dries up, they'll die. And because this just keeps getting worse, researchers have documented toadlets that have just finished their metamorphosis gathering in large groups under street lamps. The toads are probably hanging out under the lights in order to snag insects as food, but being that close to busy roadways puts the tiny toads in danger of being killed by cars, bicycles, and pedestrians. I've left a list of sources for all of this research in the description as usual. I also recommend you check out two additional studies that I don't have time to cover here. One addresses changes in birdsong timing due to light pollution, and the other examined the effects of artificial light on wildlife using under-road passages that were designed to prevent roadkill and connect habitats. These studies are linked in the description as well. Most of the studies on light pollution, except for the sea turtles, seem to focus on terrestrial ecosystems, but marine areas are being affected too. More than 22% of the world's coastlines, not including Antarctica, experience consistent light pollution from things like cities, offshore oil rigs, and other sources. sources. On top of that, in some areas, lights are intentionally used to catch fish and squid because they're attracted to lights just like insects. Unfortunately, this method can result in a lot of bycatch and the deaths of animals that weren't targeted for capture. But we've been focusing almost entirely on animals that we can see with our naked eyes. However, the victims that might be most affected by marine light pollution are the tiny zooplankton. These microscopic animals go through a nightly vertical migration through the water column, moving up from deeper waters to graze on algae at the surface during the night. If zooplankton can't tell it's night and safe for them to rise to eat because of light pollution, it could derail entire food webs within the ocean, affecting animals all the way up to the biggest whales. Other ocean invertebrates may also be affected by light pollution. The spawning events of many corals, sea stars, and marine worms are triggered by the moon's phases, but if the artificial lights in an area outshine the moon, these animals may not be able to breed. Unfortunately, like I said before, the study of ecological light pollution is still very young, and a lot more work needs to be done before we can fully understand the impacts our artificial lights have on animals and plants. But if this sounds interesting to you, perhaps you'll be the researcher to make the next breakthrough in this area. Thanks again to Quick Fix for working with me to talk about light pollution. You should definitely go check out their channel and subscribe. And if it's your first time here on The Roving Naturalist, welcome! If you liked this video, don't forget to like it. If you didn't like this video, please share it with someone who would. And if you'd like to support The Roving Naturalist, remember to hit the subscribe button and the bell notification icon. You can also follow me on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. On March 14th, I'll be doing a live stream of my master's thesis defense right here on YouTube, so stay tuned for that. And as always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.